giving them thanks for their time and their spend, wishing them well as they move forward, blessing them as they move forward. So I'm going to turn this over to Jimmy Long.
Well, good morning. This morning we are celebrating, like Pastor Helen said, our graduates. St. Mark's has been blessed to have a number of graduates complete their education this year. It's been a trying year, but our graduates pulled through and they pushed through and they did an incredible job. So at this time I'd like to invite Sean Haynes, Colin Arntz, and Erica Shell.
May the cool baptismal waters of God continue to refresh you in your endings and new beginnings. May your soul always be fed at Christ's table. May your heart always be open to the presence of the Holy Spirit. And may your mind be transformed in the mighty presence of the great I Am. God is with you. God is with us. Go with God. I might want to warn all of you that I really like to
Me?
Yeah. Yeah, that's okay. Well, he would have probably, if he had, he was here. So Saul was on his way to another city to find more disciples of Jesus so he could arrest them too. And then all of a sudden, Jesus appeared to him from heaven. It was a huge, bright, a big light, and it was so bright that Saul could see. He was blind for 3 days, and Jesus said, basically, what do you think you're doing? And Saul was all of a sudden amazed, and he realized that he was doing the wrong thing, that he shouldn't be persecuting Christians, that he should be one of them. So Saul was completely transformed, and he changed from being a very bad person to being a follower of Jesus, who went all over the Roman Empire and told everybody about Jesus and planted churches and wrote a whole bunch of the New Testament too. How do you plant a church? I know, right? You wouldn't pay, right? But if you tell people about Jesus, that's the church, right? That's a good question. Even in this country, there are still many who are sick and dying with this terrible virus, so save us, Lord. We pray for all who need your healing power. We are especially continuing to lift up Denny for recovery. We are praying for all who are grieving, in particular today with Shira's family and the loss of Zodi. In silence, we are going to lift up all the names of those dear to us who need your healing power in their lives. Lord, let us worship you today in your Holy Spirit and in the truth, who is your Son, Jesus. Let our worship be focused not on the things we do, not on where we worship, but on you. For you are worthy of all our praise and so much more. We offer everything to you through our risen Lord Jesus Christ. And as he taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. He also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain, first the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it because the harvest has come." Again he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like, or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on earth. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the word of the Lord.
So just to let you know, the Holy Spirit has torn this sermon apart about four times. This is at least the fourth major revision since Thursday. So we're going to see how this goes. It'll be an adventure. About, let's see, November 2019, I was having breakfast with a friend. That was a thing, remember? You go out to a restaurant and have breakfast with a friend before COVID. And we were talking about church stuff, and I must have been in a cranky mood, because I said, I don't know, but I'm beginning to wonder if maybe God is allowing churches to dwindle in numbers, if he's allowing us to wither and die because he wants to kick us out of our pews, because he wants us to get out into the streets. He never intended us to sit in our pews and talk to each other when the world around us is dying for want of knowing Jesus. And then we continued on with our conversation. And then the pandemic hit in March, and I thought, what if I was right? Because all of a sudden, we were literally locked out of our churches and kicked is simply, we need to keep adapting and not just roll back into the old way of doing business, because the world has changed in ways that we're still figuring out. So, if anyone understands what happens when the world changes around you in an instant, it's the Apostle Paul. They thought, apparently, that he was a mole, a spy, trying to infiltrate, and it would be hard to blame him for that. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. And Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. What seems to really resonate for the disciples, the church in Jerusalem, is that Paul was preaching the name of Jesus, and it is hard to imagine any Pharisee could speak in the, could preach in the name of Jesus without that name sticking in his mouth. You see, this is an entirely different man. It is indeed what Paul writes later in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, new creation. The old has gone, the new is come. Everything in an instant changed for Paul. He changed the way he served the Lord. He changed the way he worshiped the Lord. He changed what he thought about Gentiles. Instead of thinking Gentiles were sinners from birth, he began to recruit them into this new faith. He changed everything. And he was constantly starting riots wherever he went as a result. He was willing to do whatever it took to reach people for Jesus. He changed the way he did his work as an apostle. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and I'm going to pick up at verse 20. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God. taught us how to be flexible and adaptable. We talked about these things. He taught us how to speak in languages of the community around us. He taught us how to do worship in new ways and in new places. And now all we have to do is take those lessons and figure out how we can apply them in new ways in the way in the people around the church. Because if God really did use the pandemic to kick churches out of our pews in 2020, do you think he really wants us to go back to business as usual in 2021? I'm just going to guess no. But we need to talk to him about that. So, what do we do? Well, this is just a few thoughts. And none of this is carved in stone, but I'm going to throw out some ideas that we can pray about, think about, that we need to discern. How do we take what we learned outside and bring it forward into the new normal now that we're back inside? What if we could be a mothership for new little faith communities that we could plant all around Mount Joy? There's a group, a Brothers and sisters.